be here this morning. Glad to have you with us. I got just a few things in the way of announcements. We'll do them now. If anybody has anything they want to add to it, it'll be fine. I noticed in the bulletin there's the undescended. The pastor's been talking about for the last several weeks is today, so it looks like we're going to do something with that. Today is the day, so I'm going to throw that out there so we don't get by that. And the rest of the bulletin you can read yourself. I don't see anything in there that's going on today. This week we got our table and chairs and bookcase in from the Mennonites over on the other side of the sales, and it's all paid for. The compliments of Thrive In due to the pastor's help with getting the Thrive In cards for us. We certainly appreciate that. It's all back there, so if you have any books or something you need to put in there, it's kind of bare. I think there's a few downstairs, but we'll put back to get a few books started there, so it looks like we're using it. And no announcement. The Lutheran boys are working on some commentary. They talked to Randy Meyer, and he brought it to us elders. And the cornerstone, the old cornerstone, is still sitting back here. And the Lutheran boys have come up with a plan that they can cut a hole in the concrete here under the pastor's steps. It's a concrete thing, and they're going to rebuild those steps. Somebody might be metal, but the concrete's going to stay. They can cut a hole in that concrete to set the old cornerstone in, so it will be part. Same part of the existing church, which we feel is a good place for it. And that is the plan. They are going to cut that hole. If somebody has an objection or wants to know more about that or concerns about that, we just felt like it was a perfect spot to fix the old church. It's going to be where people can see it. So we just left it that. Anybody have any questions about that? Otherwise, that's probably the plan we're going with and probably stay with. So eventually, he won't set in there, he'll cut the hole. We don't know yet about what we're going to stick back in that cornerstone. If anything, in the old cornerstone, that's kind of grass over here. Just cut the hole for it. Location will be there at the corner of the old church. Do you have
announcements? I have something. I'm late to that, so but you're doing all the announcements now.
I think so.
There is a sign up sheet
for which day?
Cleaning day.
Cleaning day, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Sign up for cleaning day in the back of the church. And that's August 10th. Okay. Got a week or two to get your week planned to leave that open. They don't clean the school. It's all day. It's the morning. It's in Bolton, probably.
It'll be in
the
Bolton next week.
I missed it this morning. All right. Anybody else have any additions to our announcements? Our service this morning was already kind of confusing. We're doing divine service study one, which is what's in our bulletin and what we planned on doing and the information we got, but pastor had, I guess, lately talked to Marilyn and thought maybe three would be better or something, but we didn't get that information. So we're doing the same with divine service study one. And I want to ask a question. I asked Marilyn which hymn of praise we are using. And she said, well, how many of you know which one we used to do? You have any idea? Oh my God. We use this is a feast when we have communion. When we don't have communion, we use the Gloria in Excelsis on the left-hand side. I didn't know that. So I guess, did any of y'all do that? I hope you did, because I didn't, you know. So anyway, that's why we sing that this is a feast. A lot of times we sing the other one. So this morning we'll just take them on the left side, or what we call Gloria in Excelsis, I believe. So we'll be going right into that for the rest of the service. So learn something every day. And that being said, we've had the bell ring. After the opening hymn, Pastor picked a good one for us too. Thought we could do the line sort of saying, well, he had second thoughts and left us with, oh, that the Lord would guide our way. So, you want to help with that? Hymn number 707.
Thank you.
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may abide in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God. He bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Our invitation today is right on the back of our bulletin. Let's read that. The Lord is the strength of his people. He is a saving refuge of his anointed.
Savior, redeemer, bless your heritage. He is shepherd, carrier, and forever.
To you, O Lord, I call. My rock, be not deaf to me, lest if you be silent to me, I become like those who go down to the pit.
Your voice is my peace and mercy.
And with my song I give thanks to him.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The Lord is the strength of his people. He is the saving refuge of his anointed.
Thank you.
and of your great mercy keep us in the same. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Tell you,
Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says you're a fool will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there for the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you be put in prison. Truly, I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Millions and billions have come to faith in Christ.
Yet, from an outside perspective, Paul's life was terrible, full of needless suffering and weakness. And Jesus said, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Our epistle lesson for this morning brings to light another suffering that St. Paul endured during his lifetime. This one from among his beloved spiritual children in the church at Corinth. The majority of the book of 2 Corinthians is St. Paul defending himself against false charges brought up by troublemakers in the church who wanted power and status and even monetary gain for themselves. And they wanted to use the gospel that Paul had brought to gain for themselves. Their false charge that Paul is addressing in chapter 12 is that a true apostle would not suffer. There is no way that a true apostle from God would show the amount of weakness Paul displayed through his sufferings. St. Paul gives his defense against this charge by recounting a vision that he had. Upon first hearing it, our epistle lesson sounds kind of weird. Why would St. Paul be talking about being taken up into heaven, into the third heaven? Not only that, but he recounts it in the third person. There is a good reason for this. Those troublemakers in the Corinthian congregation were themselves boasting about having religious experiences. I imagine that it was a competition of who could have the most, or the most grandiose religious vision. So Paul recounts his own vision, one of many he has had. I'm going to reread part of that. "I must go on boasting, though there is nothing to be gained by it. I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who, 14 years ago, was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. Though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me." Paul does not boast in it. He does not say that he is above everyone else because he has been taken into heaven. Rather, he says he will boast in his weakness. He will boast in his sufferings. Because it is not about him and his life. It is all about Christ and what he has done for us. In this vision, Jesus says to Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." As if St. Paul's life were not hard enough, as if this vision experience was not strange enough, our lesson goes on to recount one more suffering Paul endured. Verses 7 and 8 read, "So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me." Many have speculated what St. Paul's thorn might have been. We know he had some sort of speech impediment that caused him to be a poor public speaker. But it may have also been another disease or injury of some sort. But the point is that it was given to Paul to keep him from being conceited, our text says. It is all too easy for us as human creatures to be self-centered and to take too much pride in our accomplishments, to let our heads get too big. We see it all the time with fame, wealth, intelligence. Paul recognized this thorn in the flesh for what it was. It's given from God for his own good. We too might have our thorns in the flesh. They may come and go. They may be severe or mild. We may or may not recognize them. What should a thorn in the flesh be for us? An illness? Perhaps like St. Paul? The loss of a job? Maybe it is another person we have to work with or liberate. Just like for Paul, God may be using these things for our good. We may not always understand or always see the purposes of these things, but Paul recognized another power at work in these times as well. Satan. The devil will do whatever possible to each and every one of us, so he will tempt us at the worst of times. He will use these thorns as an opportunity to get at us. Where is your God during hard times? He would ask us. Why do you have to hurt so much? All this cannot possibly be for your good. Yet Jesus promised reigns. My grace is sufficient for you. When we deal with thorns in our flesh, may we look at St. Paul as an example and imitate his action. He gives us three steps in dealing with the thorns in our flesh. Pray, don't complain, hear and hold to these words of Jesus. St. Paul prayed. Verse 8 reads, three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should be. He turned to God in prayer with his ailment, not once, but several times. He did not give up right away when he didn't get the response he wanted. In fact, Paul was imitating Christ himself, who three times in the Garden of Gethsemane prayed to God to take away his thorn. When we are dealing with thorns in our flesh, God wants us to turn to him, to talk to him, who wants communication in our relationship. Secondly, St. Paul did not complain. This is most blatantly apparent in the fact that he didn't even bother to write exactly what this thorn of his was. He wasn't complaining about it because it doesn't help anything. He also put the best construction on his thorn and saw its function in his life, rather than write a paragraph or two on how awful it was. It is good to look to one another for support in our worst times, but complaint gets nothing accomplished. Lastly, St. Paul heard and held to the words of Christ. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. The grace of Jesus is sufficient for St. Paul, and for you and me, because it is that grace that God showed his ultimate power. Jesus himself had a thorn in his flesh, the greatest thorn that any person can possibly bear. Jesus bore in his flesh the sins of the entire world, your sins and my sin when we slack in prayer, when we complain needlessly about things in our lives. Whatever sins come from the thorns in our lives, Jesus bore them in his flesh, took them to the cross, and left them dead in the empty tomb after he had risen triumphantly from the dead. That is precisely what St. Paul turned to in his hour of misery. And that is what he points us today, God's power displayed in the seeming weakness of the cross. God's power is not always shown through great, mighty acts. His power is sometimes shown in our human weaknesses still today. Again, millions of people have come to faith through the seemingly powerless life of a suffering St. Paul. Natural disasters seem to bring the best out of people as we come together to help in relief efforts. The seminary enrollment skyrocketed after 9/11, for example. Family relations often become closest in times of sickness or death. We can see the good in these cases most clearly And we follow the example of St. Paul, who lived the example of Christ. Pray, don't complain, and hear and hold to the words of Jesus. My grace is sufficient, for my power is made perfect in weakness. One thorn in the flesh that we as Christians in America have not had to deal with as intensely as in other parts of the world is that of persecution for our faith. But for some, exercising their Christian faith is in itself a thorn in the flesh. For example, there was a Muslim man who converted to Christianity being interviewed by a Christian organization. His confession of Christ had cost him everything. No sooner had he been baptized than his possessions were taken from him, and his friends and family deserted him. He was asked how he could bear everything that was happening to him. His answer, many ask me that, but they never ask me whether I am able to bear my joys. For I enjoy a happiness in my heart, since I know that Christ has forgiven me, and that nobody has been able to take from me. Amen. Please rise at this time for our confession of faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in
God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge.
Help all to hear the word, rather to understand and those who do not know you. Look with kindness and compassion on our Synod as we gather in convention this week. That all that is deliberated, discussed, and decided may rebound to your glory and the furthering of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, in mercy, bring to your kingdom the enemies of your church and grant them the name of life. Protect and defend your church and all tribulation and danger. And sustain with your Holy Spirit our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world who experience persecution. Strengthen us and all fellow Christians to set our hope fully on the grace revealed in Christ. Help us to fight the good fight of faith, that in the end we may receive the salvation of our souls. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, bestow your grace on all nations of the earth. Bless especially our country, its inhabitants, and all who are in authority. Let your glory dwell in our land, so that the mercy and truth, righteousness, and peace may abound in all places. Bless all who serve in our armed forces, that they may serve with integrity and honor. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate Lord, graciously defend us from all calamity, fire and water, war and pestilence, from scarcity and famine, and from every other evil. Protect and prosper all who labor in their rightful callings, and let all useful parts flourish among us. Be the God and Father of the lonely and the forsaken, the helper of the sick and needy, comforter of the distressed, and those who sorrow. Look with mercy, especially upon those requested by our church, especially Russell, Boulder, Eileen, Kathleen, Alice, Thomas, Laura, Bill, Greg, and members and loved ones in our nursing homes or restricted to their homes. Lord, in your mercy. Father, as we are strangers and pilgrims on earth, help us by true faith and a godly life to prepare for the work to come, doing the work you have given us to do while it is day, before the night comes when no work can be done. And when our last hours come, support us by your power and receive us into your heavenly kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Lord, lift up his countenance upon you.